I'm delighted to introduce you to Dr. Kelley Skeff. Kelley is the George DeForest Barnett Professor in the Department of Internal Medicine at Stanford and is co-director of the Stanford Faculty Development Center for Medical Teachers. Dr. Skeff ran the internal medicine residency program for several decades. He received his MD from the University of Colorado and his PhD from the Stanford School of Education. His academic career has focused on assisting faculty and residents to improve their teaching effectiveness. The Stanford Faculty Development Center, which Dr. Skeff started in 1986, uses an approach that teaches faculty from other institutions, nationally and internationally, to train their own colleagues and house staff to become more effective teachers. Since 1986, the Stanford Faculty Development Center, under Dr. Skeff, has trained 384 faculty from 160 institutions in 16 countries to become local, regional, and national resources for medical education. These faculty have in turn assisted, and we had a little discussion about this yesterday, have assisted over 30,000 faculty and residents to improve their teaching effectiveness. Dr. Kelley Skeff has received awards for teaching and mentorship at Stanford and has received almost every national teaching award, including the AAMC AOA Distinguished Teacher Award, the first national award for career achievement in medical education from the Society of General Internal Medicine, the Association of Program Directors in Internal Medicine's Distinguished Medical Educator Award, and the AAMC's Flexner Award for Distinguished Service in Medical Education. Kelley is a regent and master of the American College of Physicians. Today, Dr. Skeff will speak to us on the topic, the evolution of medical education. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Kelley Skeff.
Thank you. Well, the other award which I've received that wasn't mentioned was that I've been invited to give the Bucksbaum Lectureship at the University of Chicago. And it is equal to any of those other awards, and I think you'll get a sense as to why I feel that way as we go forward here. I decided to change the title of my lecture, so if any of you want to leave now, it's okay. Because the more I read about this institute, the more I read about what the Bucksbaum family hoped to do, the more I decided that I needed to talk about something that was close to the heart of every physician, that occurred every time a physician sees a patient. Now, the talk on the evolution of medical education we will touch on a little bit, but I'm going to talk a little bit about the lack of evolution of medical education and focus on the history of present illness and hope to entice you to think differently about this particular area that is worth all of us thinking about. Now, no conflicts of interest. And what do I hope to accomplish? I have some goals for myself here, being a relatively selfish guy. I believe that education should be a selfish endeavor, where the students gain what they should gain, and the teacher gains what he should gain. And so I wanted to make sure I took care of myself first, okay? And what do I want to do? One, the colleagues here, as I was anticipating coming, I got more and more excited on the plane, told them, get faster, faster, I said to the pilots. Because the people who are here represent the highest level of academic achievement and the human level of colleagueship that one could only hope for. And I've had the fortune during the last three decades or more to work with people from here. And also, the educational program has been very nice to me because it trains students who came to Stanford, and then I looked like a terrific program director. In fact, one of your students took my job, and I'm not happy about that. No, I'm quite happy about that. So the current program director trained here and is now the program director at Stanford, and I am so elated that I was able to recruit him to come. I had no idea that he was going to make my life so much easier later, but he did, after 20 years as a program director. And this institution provided a theoretical background for my career. Now, the next few slides I'm going to show you, I will bet very few of you know. And that's that I'm going to highlight four people whose commonality is the University of Chicago, and without whom I would probably have no career. It starts with John Dewey. Born in 1859 in Vermont, University of Chicago. John Dewey was a commentator on the meaning of American education. Ralph Tyler, born in 1902. Ralph Tyler was key for the development of the basic principles of curriculum design, University of Chicago. Benjamin Bloom, 1913 to 1999, University of Chicago. Benjamin Bloom is affecting every one of you every day, because Benjamin Bloom developed Bloom's taxonomy for education. And every time you write a set of objectives to get continuing medical education, and they tell you to use verbs that are other than know and learn, any of you have your CME verbs sent back, please, you can't use the words know, and you can't use the word learn, because Benjamin Bloom helped the entire field of education in the United States recognize that many teachers were not specific enough in the educational goals that they had for their learners. And so Bloom's taxonomy is something that affects every one of us today, and he was a key person affecting my education. And then Lee Shulman. Lee Shulman has had a major impact on American Educational Research Association. Lee Shulman trained here with many of the faculty here, and then is probably one of the most influential educators in the country. Lee Shulman and Arthur Elstein, after Lee left Chicago and went to Michigan State University, wrote the first textbook on medical problem solving. As they interviewed third-year medical students to understand the psychological process that medical students went through in problem-solving. So first, I owe you a lot. And each of you who go through this institution will have the same set of debts to this place that I have. And so get ready. Well, what did I decide? Why did I decide to change my title and work on the history of present illness? Because I think there's something I want to offer to you that will help you as a physician and a teacher to improve the clarity, efficiency, and usefulness of the patient history. And for the trainees here, the medical students and the residents, how many medical students and residents do we have in the audience? Okay, plenty of mental power, okay? But point is that I'm hoping to give you new approaches to the history of present illness for your patient that will make you even a more effective physician than you are right now. Some of you are first-year medical students, so the time is yet to come, okay? And what's the reason for this whole thing is the reason for the Bucksbaum Institute. For the patients with whom we talk, who would like to have their story heard and understood, and the main key part of this lecture is analyzable by care providers. Because there's two pieces of the work that we do as physicians. One is the humanistic connection that we have with patients, and the second is a diagnostic analyzer of what the patient's problems happen to be. And the patients need both of those in order to succeed. Okay. Now, to think about this with you, I'm going to take you to some work that we've done in trying to give you a scheme for thinking about teaching and a scheme for thinking about medical care. And what I've learned is I get to talk to audiences like you who are made up of really, really intellectual people, is the best thing I can do for you is give you a scheme to think about something and let you then run with that. So here's a scheme that we developed in 1986 for defining the process of teaching. Now this scheme suggests that all teaching interactions have a triangular center surrounded by a context. Now what's in the triangle? The teacher, the person being taught, and the content being taught. And if you and I think together, we'll see that each of these arrows becomes key as to whether the learners who are with us as teachers will end up leaving in a different way than they came. Okay? The relationship we have with learners in a positive way changes how learning occurs. How we present the content and whether we've developed a way for the learner to interact with the content becomes key. And then the circles, which we left off of our first diagram, are crucial. The context in which teachers and learners live changes what happens in that educational environment. If you and I as a teacher are being influenced very dramatically by what's going on around us, some of you may find, as teachers, that you may have less time to teach than you did before. How many of you faculty have had that feeling that there's less time now to teach? Right. So the outside influence is influencing us. It's also influencing the people we're teaching. What is the outside world telling the students? Get a good grade. If you get a good grade and a good letter, you're going to get a different residency than if you don't get a good grade and a good letter. And a good student knows, I better be very savvy about this. I better listen to the outside world telling me about my grade. And I told the students at noon about my discussion with my biochemistry teacher, the medical student, when my biochemistry teacher was trying to teach me the meaning of the world of biochemistry, and I told him I'd like to understand Bunsen burners. I hope you see the humor in what I just said. He said, biochemistry is what makes the world go around. I said, and how do you run a Bunsen burner? And when he was marching against the Vietnam War, I was realizing he had a, I didn't realize at all about this man who was connected with the world. So what I'm saying is that this teacher's understanding of the content and my understanding of the content was totally different. But tonight what we're going to do is focus on what is it we're teaching in medicine. And Laura Mumford came from Johns Hopkins to our faculty development course in 1988, and she said the same triangle represents what happens to us in the patient's office, in the physician's office. Let's talk about this for a moment. Huh? Oh, was she here? See, there it goes again. So Laura Mumford was here before she went to Hopkins. Well, she helped Hopkins, and then she came and helped us at Stanford, so thank you again. So Laura said, well, this triangle is the same triangle, that how we relate to patients is crucial to the patient-physician interaction and how patients do. What the physician must know about disease is crucial. Whether patients know about their disease is crucial. How physicians relate to their environment, how the patient relates to their environment, and how the environment influences disease. All crucial parts of the curriculum. Now what I want to do is give you a moment to look at this diagram and talk to the person next to you about what arrow you think the University of Chicago is spending most of its emphasis on today. And I'll give you a moment, it'll take a while. So please chat with the person next to you. Did you come up with any particular arrow up there that you think might get more emphasis than the others? You're smiling as you're looking to the left side. Please help me with that. What did you see? They learned at noon that everybody's fair game in here to talk because we're having a conversation. What did you notice? Which one's getting the most emphasis? You actually believe that? No. So that's true in every institution in this country. The physician's knowledge of disease is the essence of what we're doing in medical school. And the Bucksbaum Institute is here. The school is here. Now I'd like you to look again at the diagram and identify any arrow that you think is impeding healthcare delivery in this country now. And I'll chat with your friends about that. Which arrow do you think up there might be relevant to healthcare delivery in the United States that could be made better? Let me let you think about that. You can talk. Now let me suggest for a moment that we make this a forced choice question. And you're going to be president tomorrow. And I would be very happy if you were president tomorrow. But you're going to be president tomorrow and you get to choose one of these arrows to focus on. Talk with your colleague now about which is the one you think is the most important that's impeding healthcare delivery in this country. Go ahead, pick an arrow. Okay, it's forced choice with time limits. All right, so let me just see. How many of you said it's the patient's relationship with their environment? Oh, okay. How many of you said it's a relationship between a patient and physician? One. How about the physician's relationship with his or her environment? More, okay. How about the patient's knowledge of their disease? The physician's knowledge of disease. The environment's influence on disease. Notice something. The curriculum is here. The healthcare problems are here, 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 here. So in another talk of the evolution, we would talk about what we would do if we started to work on these things. But do we really have to work on how the physician works within their environment? Is the environment at all impeding the relationship between a physician and their patient now? Oh, not much. Is the environment impeding the physician's knowledge of disease now? Well, I'll tell you, I can't get residents to take time to look up issues on the patient's problems because they've got to move the patient through. So if we say that there's an issue that this patient has that we don't understand, it's not uncommon for the resident to say to me, we'll look it up later, and later never comes. The hours regulations have been put in by the Accreditation Council in order to make it possible for interns and residents and faculty to have more time to read. And they're reading more dramatically. Not true. Not true. In the era of balance in life, give me time off and I'll tell you what else I can do besides my work. So we're backfired. The environment has affected the physician, the patient, and it would be okay if that was simple enough, but it's worse. The geriatrician said to me, that's a simple diagram, it doesn't tell the story, because it's not only the physician, it's the physician and the team that's taking care of patients. Well, I said, that's no problem, because physicians are wonderful team members. Why is everyone laughing? If we decide to make a great team at the University of Chicago, and we say, who do we want on it? And the administration of the hospital picks usually several physicians. And did I say that correctly? No. Because it's turned out that we aren't often considered great team members. Sometimes we're considered great team leaders, were we to be asked, but not necessarily great team members. I'm being facetious a little bit, but the point is that this has become a problem. I told the students at noon that the CEO of the hospital, as a colorectal surgeon, said that he found out in his team that his nurses in the operating room would allow him to make a mistake and they wouldn't tell him before he made it. Why? Because they didn't see him as a team member. They saw him as a threat to them. So it turns out that as physicians, we may not have nailed becoming a team member. And for me right now, a whole lot of my current work and interest is in this area about what are we doing to contribute to the hospital's help of us to be better physicians. And there's work to be done there. So the evolution of medical education, and I'll just hold this for a moment, is to say for the students and residents and faculty that almost every one of these arrows is in need of tremendous attention. And any one of us could have another career to just focus on any one of the arrows. Now, what do I want to focus on here? There's something we call the history of present illness. That we talk to a patient to find out what's happened to them. And we ask them to tell us what's going on between their environment and them and this disease they have. And while they're talking, we try to figure out what this disease is. So we're trying to have these two sides of the triangle connect with each other. So I want to talk to you about how we teach that and how I think we teach it incorrectly. How are we going to do this? I want to go with you, review with you the history of the history. When I started getting interested in this and looked at the literature, I had a gold mine. Somebody had written an article of the history of the history. And I'll share that with you. And then I want to suggest a structure about how we might re-examine how we write the history and a framework for understanding it. Because when I suggest the structure to you, some have said to me, you're very insensitive. If we do what you're suggesting, our sensitivity to patients is going to go way down, which is the last thing in my hope. And so I will try to help you to make sure that doesn't happen and share a few patient stories with you. So what did written about the history of the history? An Australian physician, Jonathan Gillis, wrote in the Johns Hopkins Bulletin History of Medical Education, he wrote about the history of the history since 1850, and I hope you enjoy this. So I want to set you up here for some humor, and the humor will be looking at us as a profession for the last 150 years. So what was learned as they looked at what was written? Patients have difficulty telling doctors their story. We all agree with that. Doctors have difficulty understanding the story, okay? So to address this, some rewriting was done that suggested that you and I, the physician, can get by this by focusing on objective signs and try to underemphasize the subjective symptoms of the patient. Because the subjective symptoms relate to how a person experiences things in their mind. It's more about feelings and opinions rather than facts. So as good scientists, we should go for facts. And therefore, this can be a problem. I'm hoping to make a case to worry you here. And so the writing went on to say that physicians will give you an unformed, inchoate history, or rather patients. And they may ramble and give opinions. And lo and behold, they will give other doctors' opinions and other irrelevant detail. Should I say that again? Okay, you guys are a little bit here. I want to have a little more humor in the room. When other doctors' opinions are irrelevant detail, that's got to be a worrisome. Now, have you ever experienced that? I want us to think a bit, because we do it. Somebody says, I saw someone else and they said this, and we said, now tell us what's really going on. As if somebody else from another institution really doesn't have the same skills and abilities as we might have at this institution. The Meccas are quite remarkable around the country, but they're multiple ones, okay? But they were taught to the student, time is lost, but bear with the patient in order to analyze them. Do not let the patient know you're analyzing them. So this was really fascinating to me. Let me let you read this. Can you all see it on the back? Okay. I'm counting the smiles in the audience by gender. So here's the point that even teaches unconscious bias or conscious bias, that whenever we see somebody, we will underestimate. And women's heart disease, as you know, had a delay in diagnosis. Well, we wonder whether this had anything to do with it. Okay. Let me let you keep reading. You okay? Have any of you heard of anything like this? To remember that the physician must remain aware that these patients are his public. The source of his custom, the taking of a history, was a physician's shop front. If you were to give an analogous comment on what we do now today to that, what would it be? Have you heard of Press-Ganey? Press-Ganey, the patient rates the physician on the shop front. The patient says whether that physician's visit was a worthwhile visit. And do you think physicians are in all responding to that now? You better believe it. Institutions want our ratings on patient ratings of us to be very, very high. And I had a physician say to me, I really am tired of doing things for the patient to get a high rating when I know that I'm actually doing the wrong thing for the patient. Why would I say such a shocking thing in this audience? Because we have to re-examine whether we're being influenced by the outside environment to do something that we believe will get us a higher rating, much like the Uber group or the Amazon group. Now, I got into an Uber cab and he said, you're a 5-star. I said, no kidding. I said, what is a 5-star Uber rider? I didn't hit any driver or what? Said, you were never drunk. Never drunk when you got into the Uber cab. So they don't like to pick up drunks. For those of you who have a drinking tendency, you may drop to 4 or 3 stars, okay? But the scare was that I had actually seen a letter at an institution, a draft of a letter to ask patients to give us 5 stars. I said, what has happened to our field? Okay? So the history is suggesting that we have to remember we're going to get stars, but we have to also know that the patient isn't telling us what they ought to be telling us. So there's a distrust model going on here. The essence of the Bucksbaum Institute, patient-physician interaction. But there's more advice. Sit quietly, even if you're sitting on hot coals. This is for medical students. And wait for a favorable moment to interrupt with the patient. It goes on further. The British were very good at this. They had techniques to deal with this. The patient can be readily stopped in talking by asking them to show their tongue. This step being followed by appropriate questions while the tongue is out, understand? Okay. While the patient is speaking, don't be idle. You can still study them more carefully. Well, I found this rather humorous about us because in many cases I could empathize with what they were describing, empathize from my own feelings. And I said, gee, we have been trained to start with a distrust of those people whom we are taking care of. Now, what do we do with that distrust? Well, it turns out that things changed in the 40s. In the 40s, Freud came along and feelings became important, and so there was an attitude shift for history taking to move into patient connection. And people in the New England Journal and others wrote The history is key to the diagnosis. Errors in diagnosis are traceable to the lack of acumen, and the secrets of obtaining a history were tacked in diplomacy, understanding and sympathy, putting the patient at ease. So for 60 to 70 years, we were told it's a very important time to keep the patient comfortable. Now, what I'm worried about is that we went overboard. Okay. We went to say the patient has difficulty telling, we rely on methods, we believe in patient respect, and it's brought us to the current method of the patient history. So now I'm going to be heretical. I have my flight out of town tomorrow morning, and so I'm going to try to be as controversial as possible and say, what are we teaching our students now to do in taking the patient history? And from what I can tell, pretty well nationally, we are suggesting that they report the patient's history, and her story in prose. Now, I don't know if it's true, but I'd like you, how many of you, let me just have you hold your hand up, have looked at a patient's record in the hospital in the last month? Okay, now, keep your hand up if you would, please. Those of you with your hand up, would you say that the history of present illness was written in the paragraph form? If so, keep your hand up. Okay, so three hands went down. Okay, so what we've defined here is that most people who are looking at our histories are seeing prose. And I want to get you to be very doubtful about the effectiveness of that. And then I'll leave town, okay? All right. Prose. Report the story. And here's what I think the students are told, and please tell me if this isn't true here. To have your story be relevant. Any of you heard anything about relevance to the story? Have it support your conclusion. Okay, of the teachers here, have any of you ever said to the students that the history should support your assessment and plan? How many of you have said that? Okay, a few of you. What did the other of you say? Should the story be related to the assessment and plan? Let's talk about that for a moment. Now, what are we talking about? The history is a time when we are getting information from the patient. And we're saying, tell the part of the story that you got from the patient that's relevant to the patient history. Now, what I'm going to suggest to you is that if we continue to use prose, we may omit symptoms that are important, we may do premature integration, we may summarize too quickly, and we may put in hypothesis generation before we finish collecting the data. Okay? So, I want to give you a case example. So here's a case for you that happened for me. A 79-year-old lady calls in and says, I can't walk. When I put my feet on the ground, as of this morning, the soles of my feet hurt so badly, and my feet are numb from the ankles down, that I can't walk. And so the physician talking to her said, well, tell me what's happened in the last month or so. She said, I went to my doctor about a month ago, and I had a flu-like syndrome. And he examined me and he said, I think you have a urine infection. There's some cells in your urine. I'm going to put you on an antibiotic. Put her on an antibiotic. She said she got a little better. And then he went back 2 weeks later, and the cells were still in the urine. He asked her to continue to take the antibiotic. And now, 2 weeks hence, she can't stand on her feet. So what I'd like you to do is talk to the person next to you about what you think she has. Well, Mark is sharing with me about different institutions that change the order of events. So let me just get a sense of what people thought of. I don't want to put the onus on the students here because they're still just getting going. But those of you who are older than being a student, I'm walking up the, a lot of people seem afraid as I'm walking up the aisle here. But let's just get a sense. What did you think?
This is going to be something weird and we missed something in the history.
What do you think? Any guess what we missed?
I didn't think it was going to be weird, and we missed something. I think it was antibiotic toxicity, potentially.
Yeah?
Our zebra was Guillain-Barré, but...
Uh-huh. So, a zebra was Guillain-Barré from the syndrome.
We shot in acute HIV from Viagra being used in a skilled nursing facility.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Well, two really common ones, right? The nursing facility Viagra syndrome, which is the one that we're seeing a lot of. Now, no, I'm not. Okay. So, but we have here Guillain-Barré, nursing facility Viagra, and antibiotic toxicity.
Ciprotoxicity.
What's that?
Yeah.
Ciprotoxicity.
Yeah.
Ciprotoxicity. Well, she didn't get cipro.
She got macrodan.
She got what?
Did she get macrodan?
Did she get, there's a question about whether she got macrodan. Why would anybody ask such a question? Because it causes neuropathy? How many people in the room here know that macrodan can cause a very severe neuropathy? How many people here before I got here knew that? One, two, three, four. So what does that say? Five. So what does that say? That if I'm a physician who relies on what we teach, which is called patient histories, case studies, then I have to have seen this before. But if I'm a physician who simply takes the history, I won't leave until I say, and what antibiotic did that physician give you? In other words, if I take the history without judgment of its relevance, then even I, who didn't know that, can look up very quickly macrodan and neuropathy, and the computer starts making a lot of noise. So what we have to ask ourselves is, are we training people to be able to work in the absence of knowledge, or are we training them with illness scripts to only get the diagnosis when they know the script? And I know that students are now being trained around the country to learn as many illness scripts as possible, and I would suggest to you, you can never learn enough. Second case, 19-year-old woman who can't stop vomiting. Diagnosis. Talk to each other about that. And took this history from this 19-year-old woman. She took a very good history and said, and tell me what makes it better, and tell me what makes it worse, and tell me when it started, and tell me when it stopped, and every time it changed, tell me more, tell me more. And this 19-year-old lady said, sometimes I feel better in a hot shower. To which the intern said, so do I. No, I'm being a little facetious. The intern did not say that. But it's very easy, and I want to make the case, that if you and I think that it's inconsequential, we won't note it. That if we take the history and we write it in a way that we put in what we think is relevant, we may or may not put in hot shower. But if you take the moment now to get on the computer and put in hot shower and vomiting, it'll say, yeah, cannabis hyperemesis. We all seen it, we've all known it, we've all had it. No, that's not true, none of those things. Okay, the point is that we have to develop a method of taking the history that allows us to not have knowledge. We have taught people to take the history that you will ultimately know enough about everything that you will be able to know every illness script, and I can assure you, you will never win. Okay? So our history has to be not as synthesized and not as with our judgment of relevance, but our judgment of completeness. So I'm going to make a suggestion that we start taking it in another way. This is not a new way. I suggested the other day that Adam used this method when he chatted with Eve about what went wrong. This is an old method. This says, do it chronologically, but don't make prejudgments. Structure the two key variables, time, beginning, now, and what? Time and what? When did it start? How did it change? And tell me the time. Okay. Stanford student Matt Goldstein said, Dr. Skeff, nobody will buy this if it doesn't have a name. So he named it, called the Chronology of Present Illness. Okay. Now, how does the note look in the chart? Time, 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 time. Okay. Suggesting it may enhance the clarity of the timeline. It may give the physician a method for analyzing the case. It may enable clear contemplation of the evolution. Now, I'm hopeful that none of you have read the article I wrote. How many of you have read it? I'm delighted none of you have read it. So I'm going to give you a break. I'm going to give you a page of that article, which is going to take a note from the Stanford charts that one of the third year residents wrote, and she gave me permission to put this in the article. So I want to let you pretend that you're on night call, and you're called to see this patient, because the patient's having trouble, and you decide to open the EMR and look at the HPI, something you do a lot. And what I'm finding is that that's not true. That people are opening the HPI, and where are they going? To the assessment and plan. So if the original assessment and plan is not correct, it often never gets adjusted by the history, because nobody's reading the history. So I don't want you to have the pleasure of reading this history. So I'm going to give it to you here. Now, I did that. And so if all of you want to know, you can make the slide go away. And you should all know how to do that. Okay? That there's a button here that says slide go away. And you can do that. So I'm going to give you, I want you to feel the moment of going onto the wards and opening the EMR and looking at this patient's history and reading it for the next moment, minute or so. Here you go. So at this moment, when I shut off the slide, each of you had an emotion in your body, in your mind. You felt something when I set off the slide. What did you feel?
Cheated.
Huh?
Cheated.
By whom?
You.
Oh, by me. Okay. Well, that's okay. I'm the invited guest. What else did you feel about the note? Anybody?
That's too long.
Too long. Too long.
Looks good to me, but I don't
look know. Fine to me. Looks good to me. Okay, good. Hannah?
Hard to get through.
How many of you felt elated? Ecstatic. Feelings of clarity and wisdom from reading it. A sense of understanding. A sense of comprehension. So we're writing notes now that often make people do what the residents tell me they do, which is in the middle of this note, they take their clicker and go to the assessment and plan. What did they think it finally meant? And then we will act on that. And if we're a busy attending coming on rounds, and we have 20 patients to see, we act on it as well. Because we don't have time to cross-check it. So I want to give you another history to look at. Ready? I gave you approximately the same amount of time. And one allowed you to see the history and not have to dissect it or synthesize it or change it. And one had the synthesis going into it. And the challenge that I'm feeling in this era of diagnostic errors is that many of us are seeing patients without having the whole history, because we're asked to do a prejudgment based on our knowledge. So when we say to the students, put in the relevant information, hot showers was relevant, only if you know. Macrodan was relevant, only if you know. So for you to ask me to be relevant is only depending on my history of my knowledge. And the knowledge of medicine is here, and your knowledge is here, regardless of how long you've been in the business. Four people knew about macrodan neuropathy in this audience. This is an audience that probably has 500 years of clinical experience in it. So if you only practice for 500 years, you'll know this. It's just a long career, okay? So we have to build in ways to keep us from having that. Please, I've stimulated somebody here, yeah. I want to support you, okay? So I'm suggesting that the history taker, the colleagues, the teachers, the healthcare system, and the patients can be benefited by a clear note that's chronologically outlined. Now here's what a student told me. That suddenly she became brilliant overnight. So I promised students that on the rhyme evaluation, they will move up one notch simply by being understandable. So for attending to have an understandable student, the student's intellect goes up high. But while we're listening to the stories, it makes it hard because you're asking them to synthesize before they have synthetic ability. Okay. Now, we did a study at Stanford that's just going to be published next month in JAJIM, where we took the residents on night float, and we let them write their note for the first week of night float in their usual way, and the second week we made them do it in the CPI. And then we asked them to rate how their notes were before and after in terms of clarity of the note, of the verbal sign out, of the assessment and plan, even the quality of patient interaction. And they bumped. They said the patients were elated when they said to the patient, I want to know everything that's happened to you, but I need to know it chronologically for me to be a good diagnostician. This is having the patient do doctor-centered care. Patient says, doctor says, I need to have you help me make a better diagnosis by telling it in a manner which I can understand. And patients often say, well, we know about that. We know what happened on our birthday. We know what happened on Christmas. We know after that. And here the day team residents who received the patients had the same bump. So they felt their clarity of the verbal sign out went up. Their clarity of the written note went up. The efficiency of the sign out. The preparedness for them to present. And we did this study because the team was presenting me a patient that I couldn't understand. And I said, who's the resident that wrote up the note? I sent her the article. She started using this method, and she's now the advocate, okay? Because she said the patients are now happy that they're getting a complete story. So I'm going to suggest to you that we start doing this. Now, there are some barriers to this. Residents, the interviewer said, what would prevent you from using the CPI? So here's what the resident said. The longer it is, the better job they did. Never to be read again. Okay? If any students ever heard to write a long note, it's not long enough, you'll hear it. Okay? How were you taught in medical school? Let me let you read it. So I, as an attending, listening to a history of a patient being presented by a student or a resident, if they only give me the knowledge that they think that I want to hear that has them synthesize the case, if I have happened to see the microdentin neuropathy, I will not know about it. And if I don't have time to go in and take a better history, I will not know about it. But if they give me the full history, then we can capitalize on collective wisdom and this incredible machine we have now that can look all these things up for us quickly, within a minute, okay? Why don't you use a CPI, we ask. The attending note expectations is a big one. That the residents feel, and they said to us, we will not be seen as erudite. We will not be seen as thoughtful if we give a clear history that doesn't have synthesis in it. So Larry Weed, who's still cooking, Larry Weed, who invented the soap note, is going crazy now. Because he's saying that we're mixing up objective findings with assessment and plan. We're taking the section when we were supposed to get the patient's history as an objective history, and we're mixing it up with assessment and plan. And so if we take it as our job as data collection, we will have a better assessment and plan. Now, what if patients are verbally or overly verbose or disorganized? Well, I'm going to suggest to you this helps them. Okay, a lot of things going on in your life. Take me back to last year. Take me back. And I, as an attending, get credit for making diagnoses because I usually ask a single question. What do you think it is? Can you tell me when you first started getting sick? Not when you first started this illness, but when you first started getting sick. Because the history of present illness now is being defined by interns and residents as that illness that has occurred right before you came into the hospital. Not what happened before. In the clinic, the resident presented me the case of a patient with renal stones. A renal stone patient, 55 years old. So that's an unusual thing to happen. What else has happened to him? Well, I put him on a weight loss pill. Really? Wonder if that's related to renal stones. And what's happened before? We walked into the patient's room and the patient says, oh, you know, I'm a stone farmer. The patient says, I started forming stones when I was 17. Now, the history of present illness for the resident was last week when I had a stone. The patient's history began at age 17. So to somebody to say, when were you first ill? He was already on allopurinol. So what did we look up on the computer? Anybody? Weight loss and renal stones. And guess what? It's like tumor lysis syndrome. That somebody who loses 30 pounds real fast gets a tumor lysis syndrome. Well, I didn't know that, but I knew the patient had stones, had weight loss, now has a new stone, and I look it up, and by golly, they're connected. But only if I do the chronology will I make the discovery. I'm hoping I'm making a case to you that your clarity of thought and your new diagnoses to be made and your excitement about medicine can get skyrocketing if you enable yourself to stay clear in the history. And if you synthesize too fast, you may miss the forest. You may miss the trees for the forest. And the clue may be one of the trees. Okay. Well, it's 6 o'clock. And so I'm just going to commend some reading to you. This place is known for patient-physician interaction. And if you just read everything Mark has written, you'll be a whole lot smarter than you are now. But when I look at patient-physician interaction, I often find that the patient doesn't give me the history and the patient doesn't think that I care. When the patient doesn't think that I care. And so two brilliant people, Stephen Cohen Cole and Julian Bird, wrote a book called The Medical Interview, And they started in 1979. When they identified behaviors that you and I as a physician can use to tell the patient that we care. Last night at a dinner discussion, we heard from somebody who is a bright person that the decision as to whether I know whether you care or not occurs within 30 seconds. Not 15 minutes into the interview, within 30 seconds. And what Stephen Cohen Cole and Julian Bird did was to identify the things that made you build a relationship with the patient. Because they said that has to happen before you analyze the patient problem. And here are some tips. And I would hope you can memorize this next slide. How do we connect the physician and the patient? And here are the words of wisdom. Empathy. To say to the patient, we understand how they're feeling, that they seem frustrated having sat in the clinic for an hour long to get to see me. That's a legitimate feeling. And that we respect where they're coming from and what they've been able to do. And that we're willing to form a partnership, share decision making. The person in the world who's made this famous is Mark. Shared decision making. But the shared decision making may not occur if the patient doesn't feel that you care about them. So in giving a talk to a group of patients, one of the patients in an oncology conference said this. Before I care what you know, I must know that you care. And statements of empathy, of caring, of understanding, of respect, connect the patient with the physician in a way that they know you care. And it doesn't take them very long to know you care. When the person says, I want to know everything in your history to help me help you, they know you care. Okay. I told the students about this email at noon. I want you to read it. It's an email from a high school principal who was at a conference with me, and he wrote this email to me. When was this written? 2 weeks before he died, last year. It says in 2016, and I would venture to say in 2017, patients are still afraid of us. Patients are still not sure we trust them. The number of patients who leave our offices saying, did I say something that upset him or her? Are many. And all you have to do is to talk to a physician whose family members have been in the hospital, and they'll tell you how true that is. That physicians are commonly afraid to call another physician taking care of a family member. Is that clear what I just said? Physicians are afraid to call another physician taking care of a family member for fear of upsetting the other physician. Now that's a horrible diatribe on our profession. So we have to think about how to help that. I'm going to end with one story for you, a powerful, powerful story of one of a respected physician at Stanford who died last year at age 96. I had him attend on the wards every time I could because he had so much wisdom. And he was so knowledgeable. He'd look up everything at age 90. He attended till he was 90. But then he couldn't keep up with the team. Claudication robbed him of being an attending. When he passed away, We were preparing his memorial service, and his daughter found a note on his desk in his home, written to him from a patient. And I want to tell you about that letter that this daughter wrote. She said, "Dear Dr. Tony, I was ecstatic to find out that you were still in Palo Alto. You will remember me and my family because you took care of me and my husband and my son. You may remember my son, Paul," the letter said. Paul had a neurological infectious disease and couldn't walk. And you said to Paul, "Paul, you have to walk. You have to make the nerves tell your muscles to walk. Paul, you have to walk. I will give you anything in the world that you want, Paul, if you will try to walk." And Paul said, "I want your doctor's bag." Now, Tony was the first cardiology fellow at Stanford in 1946. So there were still doctor's bags. So Paul asked Tony for his doctor's bag. And the letter then says, "Your bag is still at his bedside, and he just retired." Now, when we talk about patient-physician collaboration, patient-physician synthesis, patient-physician understanding, we have worked on all aspects of this triangle. And you are so fortunate to have an institute that's dedicated to that. It's dedicated to bringing together the top of the triangle with these Thomas. So I want to just take you back here. This institute is dedicated to this, and it's dedicated to collaborative work together. But you and I both can work on this, and this, and this. So I'm going to stop and tell you how wonderful it's been with you. I hope that I've shaken you up a little bit, and that the next time you look at a paragraph, you ask, could this have been made clearer? And the article will be out in February. All right, thank you so much.